Oh, yeah. Breaking the law, breaking the law. Celtics go up 2-0 on the Hawks.
Easy work.
Knicks are now even with the Cavaliers.
I don't know about
early
that
on, it was awful.
That game was awful, period.
I'm telling you, like, the game was awful. But what did I say about Cleveland and maybe some of their stars not being under the weather and that they needed some guys to be unbelievable coming off the bench? Well, Garland was as
he
a
was
starter, 6-for-10 from three.
Probably best game he's ever played.
And then LeVert off the bench, 4-for-9 from three for 24 points. So,
and Jared Allen had a really good game alongside Evan Mobley, who played really great. Donovan Mitchell came to play.
Mobley had 13, Mitchell had 17, but Garland, the shooters, stole the night.
I just hated how the Knicks got down 20 and threw in the towel. And they were done for the day.
I'm not going to say it's the Knicks. I think that's the NBA.
True.
I think they're like, okay, we're going to sit our guys down, and we're going to look to win game three. I know it sounds with the S word, but I think that's the formula that these coaches go with.
So then they kept Jalen Brunson in, who looked like he was playing pretty hard. Julius Randle, I don't know what he was doing out there.
Orange Julius
got a breakaway layup about 2 minutes in the game, and no one told Jarrett Allen that the game was out of hand and no need to play defense, and he wrecked Julius Randle, undercut him, and Julius Randle went down pretty hard. I don't know the status of Julius Randle since that fall. There's a part of me that was like, gosh, man, I mean, you're up by 20, 30 points moment, Jarrett Allen. Then another part of me was like, no easy buckets. I don't care what time it is in the game. I don't care what the lead is. This is the NBA playoffs. No easy buckets, Julius. I was disappointed in the Knicks' output, especially in the second half. No fight. No fight in the Knicks. Yeah, they won their game one. They took their ball, and they'll be going home for game three. It's 1-1 series.
Well, but they did their job.
They
got the split.
They did their job.
I don't know. I'm not the biggest fan of the 2-2-1-1-1, but it works for the NBA. I'm also not a big fan of every series after the play-in is a 7-game series. I mean, baseball doesn't do that. Other sports used to be a little bit more lenient. Now you have the NHL and the NBA. We're just going to wear these dudes out, and it's going to be attrition. Whoever can survive the 2-month playoff format.
Speaking of which, is Ja playing tonight? We got a little Ja Morant action.
I'm more worried about is Antetokounmpo playing tonight.
Antetokounmpo playing tonight?
He took a hit. Now, let me jump in on this. This is an ESPN thing, national, talking about are there too many guys taking charges in the NBA? Are you serious? You know how gutsy it is for Kevin Love to stand there at his age?
They're talking about Kevin Love, aren't they?
And getting in front of Antetokounmpo, they're basically saying, you got this guy hurt because of what you did. No. I'm not going to go for that. You know, I really believe that I think Scherzer got thrown out of this game. I think Scherzer got thrown out, coming back out for the bottom of the fourth inning. He's gone. They're bringing in a reliever right now in the Mets. Well, that's a story that's developing, so we'll continue to watch that. But he just went bananas.
Ah.
He just went bananas on the whole glove thing.
He went out there with the old glove.
I think he did.
They told him not to use it. He went and he used it. Bye-bye.
Well,
got to play by the rules.
Umpires are always instigating as well. They want to be all right, so they're showing it right now that they're trying to fix the pitch comm that was on his first glove that was attached to the wrist area. And I don't think that they were able to do it in the time in the dugout. And so I think Scherzer's bitter because they were basically like, he doesn't. What did I just say about how flaky players are? You know, you're used to something being a certain way. Now the umpires tell you can't do it. And then basically he's pleading his case that there was some sticky substance. I think they ejected him for
it. That's why. So he's trying to stick the pitch comm or his glove hand with something that has a sticky foreign substance on there. I think that's what we're talking about.
And then they checked the glove again, and they threw him out.
So he's trying to stick the pitch comm.
This is what you just said about Draymond. Watch Buck Showalter. Max, we'll get to the bottom of this later.
Count to 10.
Yep. And
I
Buck
know
is
they're
the,
wrong and you're right.
Yep, you're right. But sometimes even when you're right, you got to just admit you're wrong. Go in the clubhouse and have a beer and calm the hell down.
Listen, you want him back for his next start. You don't want him to blow up.
Well, what if you bought tickets to the Dodgers and the Mets? You're a Mets fan on the West Coast.
Don't
it's
blame
Syndergaard,
Buck.
Former Met versus new stud Max Scherzer, and Scherzer's thrown out in the fourth inning.
So I think what it is that he had some kind of foreign sticky substance to...
Right, but again, when I'm watching him pitch, he's going to his wrist every time, and it's on his glove. And so they're saying, well, listen, there's some kind of stickiness to... Now, it could be hot enough where it's tacky. And so this is when you... It's subjective here. You're giving the umpires the ability to say, we feel it's sticky, it's an advantage to you, you're gone. And now Max is like, are you out of your mind? You know, so again, you don't want to be, you know, associated with trying to cheat or spider tack or whatever, and you're being forced to use the pitch comm, and you get tossed out of the game. So we haven't heard the last of the story, but I'm here for it. I love this. Because now... Scherzer already probably hates umpires anyway, so.
And he's trying to take advantage of all these little rules and intricacies of the rules.
Dave Roberts. So Dave Roberts is now coming out. So there's a delay in the game in L.A. right now, and Dave Roberts is like, well, I won that round.
But that's just an interesting thing for the future for Major League Baseball. It's like, how are you sticking these pitch comms on there? You have to use some kind of glue in order to do it.
It looked like it was a wristband that had Velcro, you know, that wrapped around the whole thing. So remember, you have like this thing that's you stick your hand into the glove, and there's a wrist. They call it a tongue. So the tongue goes around and it's tight. So you have to take the tongue off, or you have to stick something around it while it's permanently on there. And it's, you know, it's rawhide. You could get it off there. So he probably didn't want you to mess with his glove. He told the video tech or the pitchcom tech, hey, why don't you just wrap it on there with something. You know, some form of stickiness. If it's tape, it's probably an illegal substance that's not kosher with Major League Baseball.
So Scherzer already made up the quick pitch rule that you cannot do because he took advantage of the pitch gun first. They stopped that. So now I think Scherzer's just created the adhesive rule for your pitch comp.
I think it's great. I think it's great. Scherzer right now is tearing up that visiting clubhouse in L.A., which, trust me, a few of us have torn up that visiting clubhouse
in
L.A.
You just like the chaos.
I like the chaos because, again, it makes it more interesting. There's more action to this game, and you haven't seen the last of it. It makes the rivalry great between the Mets and the Dodgers, obviously, and I can't wait for the next game. And so now Buck, he's going to have... You know, I don't know where the Mets are going after this game. If they are, because it's a getaway day, it seems like it's a Wednesday afternoon game, and the Mets are probably flying across the country or to their next destination. They're going to be stewing. And if they do lose this game and it's 0-0, here's the thing, it's a good game. Syndergaard's pitched 4 shutout innings. Scherzer's going out after 3 shutout innings, and he gets tossed. If you're there, you're loving it.
I think so, too, especially if you're a Dodgers fan. Get that guy out of there. We get some hits.
They'll be in San Francisco.
Okay, so they've got about an hour flight to San Francisco. It is going to be a lot of you-know-what kind of talking. There's going to be a lot of trash talking of, you know. And again, here's the thing. You can't control the umpires that do your next series. That sometimes umpires follow teams to the next series because they have no home base. They're always on the road, the umpires. And so if they, God forbid, that you know that this crew is at Max Scherzer's next start, he'll go bananas.
Yakabonis, is this that guy's name? Yakabonis?
Looks like it.
Yakabonis in there, got the ground ball. He's doing well.
Well, and all right, so the rule is because it's like an injury and he was ejected, that pitcher came in cold, wasn't warming up. So he has as many pitches as necessary to get ready. Again, this game has now, you know, come to a screeching halt for 10 minutes with the ejection, with the warming up and stuff like that. But this kid, you know, number 73, game's all yours for the next 4 innings.
Who knew? Who knew you were going to get your big
shot? All right, get back to the NBA, though, last night and tonight. Ja Morant. You know, we've already seen the Celtics have a lot of guys coming back from injuries. They were able to dominate last night.
Robert Williams looked really good, by the way.
And that's the thing. And I think, you know, when you're playing these 7-game series And, you know, you're already down two games right now. If you go down 3-0, you're probably toast, and Golden State knows it. But I think that Antetokounmpo, you know, that's something that if, listen, it's bothering you. Let's just say it's stiff and it's sore. If you're the Milwaukee Bucks, I guarantee they're not going to risk him.
So
it's not worth it.
They're down a game to Miami. Now, don't forget, Miami Heat will be without Tyler Hero for the rest of the way, as he did break two fingers in that hand. Hero, obviously out. Antetokounmpo, doubtful as we start right now. Wesley Matthews will also be out for the Milwaukee Bucks. Again, that's 1-0 Miami Heat in that series. The Los Angeles Lakers also lead the Memphis 1-0, and they play tonight. That's the first game tonight.
Well, and the good thing for the Bucks is they'll get an off day, maybe two off days. Probably I don't know two. What there's probably two off days. He's got to fly down there. He should be ready to go in game three if he does not play. But like I said, you know, yes, 2 days ago when this happened, how do you replace 32-12-6?
Yeah.
That's, you know, and his presence on the court. I mean, that's the whole thing. 35 minutes a game is you have the best basketball player in the league other than Embiid. Out there, and you're down a game. So now you could go down 2-0. If you're the Heat, you steal 2 in Milwaukee, you got to be so comfortable going home.
Does doubtful mean anything in the NBA? LeBron James, Anthony Davis, and Dennis Schroeder also doubtful for tonight's game, but pretty sure they're going to play, right? They had 2 days of rest. They didn't break their hand.
You're the fantasy sports
I'm asking. I'm legitimately asking.
Well, that's my point is for you, questionable, doubtful. I think they got rid of probable in the NFL.
NFL. Yeah, no more probable.
But doubtful probably, does that
doubtful,
hinder your bet?
You would think that the word doubtful means like, you know, don't count on me. It's like 95% sure I'm not going to play. There's a chance I might get out there and play like a couple minutes.
Practice, do shoot around before the game.
Yeah, I might go through layups. Right. But I've seen a lot of doubtfuls already in these playoffs that have become active. It's tough to gamble on. It really is.
All right, let's talk some NHL from last night.
All the away teams, man.
A lot of great action. Rangers in New Jersey playing the Devils. They take a 1-0 lead, 5-1. Rangers all over those Devils,
on them
man.
In a hurry.
What a fabulous game for the Rangers.
Well, the Rangers are tough, and yep. They've been there and they've done that. They had a great run last year. It's the same cast of characters, and they roughed up these New Jersey Devils in the first couple of periods. And 3-0 after the first two. They gave them a charity yep. goal at the end. Rangers dominated last night. And I'd say the same thing with the Lightning. Lightning
up in north of the border
sure
in Toronto.
7-3 final. Lightning were all over the Leafs, And it felt like the Lightning, the Rangers were just the tougher bunch against the.
I think Maple Leaf fans are saying the same thing like Buffalo fans.
It was.
Is this going to happen again this year?
It was a quiet Toronto. Last night, his Tampa Bay.
Kind of tell us what power play goals.
A lot of power
what is the music that they play after the Leafs score a goal?
What was
it? Hall and Oates.
Oh, yeah, it was. It was Hall and Oates. You make my dreams come true. Yeah, I noticed that last night. It was hard to notice because it
doesn't feel like a hockey song. I love Hall and Oates. Just.
Feels, yeah, not really hockey.
No,
esque.
You're more of the rock and roll hockey guy. Would you, if you were doing the music, would you recommend that?
No, but
it's a great song.
I mean, I maybe like Beasties or something like that. Nah, you know,
I think you guys are missing it, man.
I don't know. I'm kind of AC/DC, Thunderstruck kind of stuff.
Hall & Oates is nothing but good vibes, all the way around.
Yeah, really. Toronto. When's the last time Toronto won anything?
Recently, right?
No, not recently.
Didn't they win not too long ago? The Leafs.
Couple of decades,
but yeah, Leafs haven't won squat in a long time.
I went to a wedding that was all Hall & Oates. It was awesome. Nothing but good vibes. It was a great time. Out in the West is the away teams again. The Jets just pummeled the Golden Knights. Watched pretty much all of this game. And then the Kraken beat the Avalanche. That was a really good game. The Seattle Kraken, watch out for them, man. There you go.
66-67 last time the Maple Leafs won a championship when I was 3 years old.
I want to know the story behind why they picked this as a goal song. There you go.
Was Tim Horton still on the team when the Maple Leafs won?
Tim Horton played hockey? I thought he just made pies.
Jesus. I didn't know it was that long. I thought it was the 70s. It was the 60s.
Great song, man.
I was a baby.
Great song. So tonight, a little hockey action for all you puckheads tonight, which, by the way, just a quick one. I hear the Rangers poached some Wolf Pack for some reinforcements against the Devils, which could hurt our local Calder Cup champions.
What? Jim Caldwell Cup is in jeopardy?
It's in jeopardy.
Kind of like his coaching career.
Game one tonight, Springfield Thunderbirds. Are you tough in there? They're taking on the Wolfpack in game one of this three-game series. But, yeah, we lost some players to the Rangers. Tonight in the NHL, Islanders, Canes. That one back in Raleigh for game two. Canes up 1-0. Bruins up a game on the Panthers. Canes will start at 7. Canes Islanders start at 7. 7:30 will be Panthers Bruins. And Wild Stars, Kings Oilers on the west side for the NHL.
Maple Leafs only have been using that song since 2018, so it's not like a long kind of tradition, but I don't really have a catalyst for it.
I love these little sports traditions.
Yeah, any Maple Leaf fans out there, give us a holler, okay? 860-522-3776. We'll talk about this later.
I love what the Sacramento Kings have done with Light the Beam. I think that's really cool.
Light the Beam. Light the beam. Laser beam that's affecting air traffic controllers everywhere.
Possibly.
That's a wonderful one.
Yeah, but you know I'm if you kidding. Won.
Yeah.
It's like the Luxor in Vegas.
You can see
it from coming in.
The Luxor's always on. So you're always winning. No,
no.
The Luxor's always winning.
Yeah, that's why they can afford to keep that beam that goes up to the moon on 24/7. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back. Steve and Laurel Leibowitz are going to school you on the Northern Connecticut Miracle League and the field that is being built in Vernon.
Awesome.
We will talk to them next on the Rob Dibble Show. They'll be in studio joining us here on the Rob Dibble Show with Ben Darnell on your afternoon drive. 96.